very good morning, and let me apologize for not having been here this morning. Due to various unavoidable reasons, I could not come here. So the topic given to me was thrombocytopenia in pregnancy. What I'm going to discuss is what is normal physiology, what is the etiology of thrombocytopenia, how will it come to diagnosis, and what is the management. See, normally platelets are produced from megakaryocytes, and per day around 35 to 50,000 platelets are produced. But the survival days is only around 8 to 10 days. Normal platelet count during pregnancy is around 1.5 to 4.5 lakhs. Now, during pregnancy, when will you say a person is having low platelet count? Any time when the platelet count is less than 150, you will say a person is having thrombocytopenia. And normally during pregnancy, as the pregnancy advances, the platelet count will fall. So many studies have shown that during delivery or during labor, the counts could be around 2.3 lakhs and the lower level could be as low as 1 lakh. Even that is said to be normal physiological change. Now coming to the causes of thrombocytopenia, the causes are, in the first trimester, anytime when the platelet count is less, you will normally think it is because of ITP. That's the most important cause. Whereas in the second trimester and third trimester, the commonest cause is gestation-induced thrombocytopenia. Now there are other reasons which are more important, like could be having ITP, you could be having preeclampsia, hypertension, or other conditions like TTP and HS. These are, and very rarely other conditions. These are just generally the cause of thrombocytopenia. So the first trimester, abnormal platelet count, you think of ITP, and in the second and third trimester, the commonest is GT followed by other conditions. Now this chart I thought was important because there are very many drugs that we use routinely without knowing that they can cause thrombocytopenia. Certain antibiotics, diuretics, analgesics and anticonvulsants can cause thrombocytopenia. The commonest name, ampicillin, penicillin, rifampicillin, and analgesics like aspirin, endomethacin, and all your anticonvulsants. So you should be very careful when a person is on these drugs, would they cause thrombocytopenia? Now this is a study regarding the Indian scenario. What is the type of cases that we come across? And there again, the commonest cause is gestation thrombocytopenia. Preeclampsia and other associated conditions are there. But what is important to note is infections like dengue fever, malaria are also a very common cause. In fact, we present a case where, in an article where one of the most important reasons was dengue. Many people have very severe thrombocytopenia with dengue fever, and it is not uncommon in our part of the country. So any person with fever, you would think of a dengue or some other viral infection. Now, there's another thing that all of us must know. It's something known as pseudo-thrombocytopenia. Sometimes when you see a CBC report, the report might come as 80,000, but they would have also added platelet clumps. Now the platelet clumps is because of a condition known as pseudo-thrombocytopenia. Here there is agglutination of all the platelets which is occurring because we have sent the sample in EDTA. If you send the sample in heparin, this will not be present. So this is a condition. So it might appear as if the platelet count is really false, but in reality she might be having a normal platelet count. So let us take up one by one important causes. Gestational thrombocytopenia is by far the commonest, and it occurs in 5 to 11% of all pregnancies. The salient features are, it normally occurs in the second or the third trimester. The counts are generally above 75,000. It is asymptomatic. Platelets return to normal once the patient has delivered. And it can recur itself in subsequent pregnancies. In fact, they say it is 14 times much more common. And as far as the baby is concerned, the baby will not be able to withdraw. There is no chance of neonatal thrombocytopenia. So how are you going to manage once you diagnose it's a case of gestational thrombocytopenia? Here the diagnosis is mainly by exclusion. When there is no other reason which is present for the thrombocytopenia, you will think of a gestational thrombocytopenia. Here these patients are not at risk and you only have to follow the platelet count. So the platelet count may vary around 80,000, 90,000. So in such conditions, depending upon the platelet count, you have to follow them up. It could be monthly, it could be even once in 2 weeks. Depends upon how it is. Very rarely will the platelet count come to 40,000 or less than that. It is very, very rare. Though she is a case of gestational hypertension, thrombocytopenia, she might have a very low platelet count sometimes. In which case it is very difficult to differentiate, is it a case of ITP that we are dealing with. Now after delivery, once the platelet count comes back to normal, then it confirms that this particular person has had a diagnosis of a gestational thrombocytopenia. Now the next common conditions in our part of the country is pre-eclampsia and associated conditions. Now 5 to 11% of all cases are suffering from pre-eclampsia, and if it's a case of health, you can have platelets as low as 1 lakh. Now here in pre-eclampsia, it's not only the platelet count which is deficient, but also the platelet function which is also abnormal. Now in fact, they say thrombocytopenia may be the first sign to occur, which will herald the onset of pre-eclampsia. Now there are other conditions where you have thrombocytopenia with microangiopathy, and you have DIC, HELP, TDP and HAS, which are the other common conditions. And the way to differentiate it from one from the other is by this chart. All of us are very familiar, so I'm not going to spend much time. This chart will tell us, is it a case of epifatty liver pregnancy, is it HELP or is it TDPS and HAS. Now coming to the next important part of thrombocytopenia, maternal immune thrombocytopenia or ITP. Now here the pathology is because of impaired platelet production. However, there are no pathognomic signs to say that this particular person is suffering from ITP. It is mainly by exclusion. And here the incidence is roughly around 1 in 1000 to 1 in 10,000. Now here again, ITP may either be primary or secondary. Here it is a production of maternal IgG antibodies which crosses the placenta, and therefore the baby and the fetus might be affected. However, severe complication in the fetus is very rare, it is less than 1%. How are you going to treat this ITP? Now the goal is, you generally reduce the risk of bleeding using the least toxic therapies, and you have to only treat her when the patient becomes symptomatic or when she has a count which is less than 30,000. Because antenatally, when patients can come with a count as low as 40,000, 50,000, and spontaneous bleeding will only occur when the counts are lower than 20,000. So you try to maintain the platelet count around 30,000 and above. So there is no active intervention, except that you have to serially follow the platelet count and see if she is if it worsens or it falls. Only when the platelet count falls lower down, you have to follow her up. Or when she is nearing delivery, that is the time when you have to really do something to increase the platelet count. So under those circumstances, what are we going to do? The first kind of therapy would be corticosteroids. Now IV,
ஹரிஹரணம்
அது வீட்டுக்கு கொஞ்சம் கிடைச்சி ஆஃப் பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கேன், இதை கொஞ்சம் கட் பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கேன் பேசிட்டு.